tell you what this one was about.
All right, y'all, we live. Praise ye the Lord.
He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah.
Yes, he is.
Well, good evening, those of you out in Facebook world. If you'll go ahead and start a watch party or send this out to a friend, share it, let them know that Pastor James and Peniel Covenant Christian Center is on with Brain Change.
Amen, amen.
It's our weekly Wednesday Bible study.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
And we are so glad to be here with you tonight.
Yes, we are.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for joining us. And as we, what's my password to get in my phone? Okay, I got it.
Just to show you that we still human. Things still happen, even with us. Hallelujah.
So we're going ahead to sharing from our end. And we would like for you to grab your Bibles, grab a pen, piece of paper, something to write on. Because it is Bible study and we're studying the Word. And as God leads you to something, He may tell you something to write down. So write down so you can go back and listen to it again or reread something. Or there may be a question you want to ask. And as you tune in, we ask that you just let us know what city you're tuning in from or what state or what country you're tuning in from. For example, I would just type in Loxahatchee, Florida. So wherever you're coming from, please let us know.
Hallelujah.
Waiting for a few more people to come in.
I hope everybody had a good day today. Hallelujah. Hope everybody had a good day.
I don't know what the pastor done did, and I won't let me share.
I didn't do nothing. I'm just sharing the word of
time
God.
Time for a new phone, honey.
Call those things that be not as though they were. Maybe she gonna buy both of us one. Hallelujah.
And I might as well get in on that too.
It's not saying that I can share. You didn't make it shareable?
It's shareable.
Let me see on your phone.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
You ready to share? Mine says like and comment.
I don't know what's going on with her phone tonight.
Pastor don't want me to share.
Y'all know that's not unlike me, right? Amen, amen. Well, hey, listen, I pray that everybody had a blessed day today. I pray everything is going well. Looking forward to tonight's Brain Change Bible study. I know I am. It's been one of those days at work.
Hey, Mama Jan, you in Port St. Lucie?
So, I thank God for this opportunity to be here. I thank God that He's still keeping us through everything that's going on.
Amen.
I thank God for those that are protesting peacefully. And we all are demanding justice and changes in our justice system and every other system of inequality in this country. Amen. Oh my God, old friend of mine, old Coach Steve Kovetsky, so good to see you, man. Thought about you the other day. I pray, God, that you and your wife is all right. I know you're traveling somewhere, but thank God for this opportunity. So let us go ahead on and pray and let us move forward. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you tonight. We thank you, we praise you, we give you glory and honor. We esteem you high. Father, we thank you, first of all, for your grace, honor, and unmerited favor that's in and on our life.
Yes, thank you,
Lord God, we thank you how you watch over us and keep us, how you're protecting us from coronavirus and every other hurt, harm, or danger. Lord God, I pray right now for the family of the male that was killed today in West Palm Beach. Pray for peace and comfort and strength with them. Father, we pray right now for the families of those who loved ones have died since the last time we met. Father God, we pray for comfort and strength in their lives. Lord God, we pray right now for comfort and strength in this nation, in this world, that God, you always allow something to bring about a change, and that we thank you that a change is coming, is happening right now. Lord, we thank you for your covering. We thank you for your angels that are encamped round about us. And Father, I pray tonight that every eye is open to see what the Word of God is showing us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Every ear is anointed to hear what the Word of God is speaking to us. And every heart is prepared like that of good soil, ready to receive a seed of the Word. That seed will be planted, rooted, and grounded. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
If you missed when we first came on, go ahead and let us know where you are viewing us from, what city, what or state or country, wherever you're viewing us from. Just let us know. And you feel free to comment as we go through the Bible study or ask questions that you may have about what we're discussing. You may ask and we'll answer your questions to the best of our ability and from the Word of God.
Amen. Amen. Well, we're going back to Luke. We're going back to the book of Luke, New Testament. And remember we started last week with verse Luke 6 and 37. And we started out with judge not and you won't be judged. Hey, sis, I see you in Sebring. Condemn not and you won't be condemned. Forgive and you shall not be condemned. We thank you. We just want to praise you. And, you know, and God, we just thank God for that opportunity. But I want to go back to something and I want to hit a scripture that we did. But y'all know me. I've always got to have a prop. So let me go get my prop for tonight pertaining to one of the scriptures.
What is he going to get?
That we have. And I'm going to ask the ladies just to just kind of reflect a little bit on what Pastor Angela and I went over last week. And I'll be right back. Take me a quick second. I forgot about this because I want to start and kind of go back over verse 41. But if they reflect, give me about 15 seconds. I'll be right back.
Okay. I tell you, be ye always ready, because Pastor James will just tell you when it's about to go down. No prior warning. Amen. Okay, I'm going to start. I'm going to read 41. First, I'm going to read it from the Amplified version of the Bible, and it says, "Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice or consider the beam that is in your own eye? Mm-hmm. Or how can you say that your brother, allow me to take the speck that is in your eye, out the speck which is in your eye, when you yourself do not see the beams that is in your own eye? You pretender, you hypocrite. First take the beam out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck that is in your brother's eye." Amen. So we can't look at what somebody else is doing and try to fix them, try to correct them, try to change what they're doing without judging our own self. Because they're looking back at us like, okay, how you gonna tell me about that? And you doing some of the same things I'm doing. So we got to first judge ourselves, take that beam that out of our own eye before we go to sweep around somebody else's front door.
Amen. Amen.
Because and we have all been guilty. I've been guilty of that. We just see what they're doing wrong, and we want to jump in and tell them what they need to do and get upset when they fire back at you about what you're doing. Amen. Pastor.
I tell you, that's well, boy, I tell you, the Word of God is true all by itself.
Amen.
And make us look at ourselves and make us, you know, say ouch and all that other kind of stuff to make us, you know, just be more compassionate.
Amen.
With other people. And that's basically what God is saying, you know, judge yourself.
Judge yourself.
Quit looking at somebody else. You know, look at yourself and like
evaluate.
You said, yeah, and let the Holy Spirit clean you up.
That's right. I can't tell somebody how they need to take care of their husband and don't talk to your husband like that and don't do this to your husband, what you should be doing until I first examine myself and make sure I'm doing what the Word says for me as a wife to do with my own husband.
Amen.
Doesn't matter your title, doesn't matter your where you live, it doesn't matter how much money you make. Right is right and wrong is wrong.
And also, she said husband, but that also goes for a husband looking at his wife.
Or children. You know, I just use that as an example.
I know, but I want to do this example of what a beam in the eye is.
Okay. Did he get that big old?
So this is a beam.
Jesus. Don't let that stick fall like, over here on me.
This is your eye. And you see that beam? You know the beam is on a certain length, but according to your eye, it looks like it has an infinity edge. Yeah. It just keeps going. So you have to pull the beam.
Out of your own eye.
Out of your own eye. Before you can start to correct somebody else.
What's going to happen?
So, because if you don't take the beam out your own eye, they're going to call you a hypocrite. They're going to talk about you.
Oh, my God.
You know, they're going to say you always want to tell somebody else what to do.
You pretend.
But let's look at your life. You know, you want to tell somebody to stop tricking, but every time they turn around, you got a different car pulling up to your house with somebody staying the night. Mm-hmm. You know, you want to tell me I shouldn't smoke, but every time I look at you, you smoking. Whether you got a cigarette, e-cig, a dime bag, a nickel bag, you always got rolling up some. So take the beam out your own eye. Take the speck. Take the beam. Pastor, this is the beam. Hold Pastor, on, hold
they
on.
They told me the e-cigarette's not real cigarettes.
I don't care what they told you. They got nicotine there. You take the beam out of your eye. So you take this beam.
Then you get the speck.
You take your faults. You take your shortcomings.
Wow.
If you judge yourself, if you evaluate yourself, you don't have time to be criticizing nobody else.
I don't know where it is, but I will say this. It is written. Mind your own business.
Yes.
It says that in the word. Mind your own business.
And you see, and that's so important because we as human beings in our human nature, we love criticizing others. And I'm not talking about what we call constructive criticism to help build them up. No, we like to be negative.
Picking apart.
What I mean, we like to gossip. We need to talk about how they raising their children, but not recognizing your children ain't good. They some hell news too. But you want to overlook that and you want to criticize everybody else. No, like my wife said, like the song said, sweep around your own front door first. Clean up your own house. Before you try to criticize somebody else's house.
And while you're cleaning up, make sure the same way you wouldn't want me to come in there and talk about your stuff that you know you pushed under the rug, don't come in mine talking about mine. The same compassion you want me to have for you, have for me.
Because if I find out you're talking about my house, you ain't coming back.
Well, I would say, just want to clear some things up. If your brother or sister, if you see your brother or sister in Christ doing something that it goes against the word of God and they're living in a certain way, it's a way to approach them.
Yes, it is.
It's a way you go to them in love. You, first of all, I would suggest that you pray and you ask God how you should approach them and to give an open door and the right time for you to approach them without you trying to hurt them or embarrass them. Now, they're not going to like it. So for that person, it's never going to be a perfect time, but you ask God for the timing, and when he opened the door for you to speak to them, then you go in and you do what you need to do. You say what you need to say, but make sure you do it in love and make sure you have the word. And when I say in love, I don't mean you got to say, now James, you know, no, you got to, there's a different way to approach everybody. Know your audience, know who you're talking to and how you need to speak with them. So ask God to give you that wisdom when you step to them with it.
Well, the word before, at the beginning of that, he was talking about, as you said, don't judge, because if you don't want people to judge you, the same way you want someone to handle you. And then a lot of times, you know, we might be rough around the edges. You know, we might have a different disposition than somebody else. You know, my disposition as far as human-wise might be different, but when we're dealing through, you know, the Spirit of God, it has to be the disposition of the Holy Spirit that we got to go in, because, as you said, take your time, and when you go pray, so God will tell you how to speak to that person, because God know his sheep, God know his children, God knows how to talk to them, just like he was talking about, you know, your children, and I'm talking about my child. If I want you to speak to my child, if my child is not hearing me and I come say, Sabrina, can you talk to my child about thus and thus and thus, I'm going to tell you what's going on, and you would know, you might be more lenient with my child than you are with your child.
Maybe, yeah.
You know? So, but if you come in under the, you know, the unction of the Holy Spirit, you're going to say, oh, now God help me to know how to talk to this person. How can they receive it? And even if you walk away and it look like they don't receive it, that don't mean they don't receive it.
Amen.
That's true.
Because the Holy Spirit will work later.
I know with my son, sometimes, and my daughter, it seems at times when I'm talking to them as if I'm talking to the wall. Like, and I'm trying to say it as nice as I can say it and as firm and as fair as I can say it, but it seems as if they're not paying any attention and they just say, okay, and they walk off. But years later, I've heard them say some of the same things that I taught them or was teaching them, and I thought they were not paying attention.
Amen.
So,
amen. Well, I want to read those two scriptures just for clarification.
Oh, hold on, Pastor. I'm so distracted. I'm looking at the screen. Why is that block on my face?
Ain't no block on your face, girl. Be quiet. Y'all don't pay no attention right now.
I'm so distracted.
She paying attention to the
I'm
monitor
looking at
right
the
here.
Monitor, and this is like a block over my face. I'm like, why?
All right, boom, there it is. I moved it over. I moved over my face now. Let me read those two scriptures from the Passion Translation of the Bible, and it says, "Why do you focus on the flaw in someone else's life and fail to notice the glaring flaws of your own life? How could you say to your friend, 'Here, let me show you where you're wrong,' when you are guilty of even more than he is? You are overly critical, splitting hairs, and being a hypocrite. You must acknowledge your own blind spots and deal with them before you will be able to deal with the blind spot of your friend." One thing that I am steadily learning as a pastor, as a human being, as a husband, as a father, whatever my role is, I am not perfect. And neither are God's children. So I can't criticize you without criticizing me first. Because if I know I'm doing wrong, then why should I make you feel like you're no good? Because if I evaluate myself, like I said earlier, then I have no time to be evaluating you. Mm-hmm. See, a lot of us, we are trying to make people fit into a mold that we can't fit in. Mm-hmm. We are trying to make people be who we want them to be instead of allowing them to be who God created them to be.
Amen.
But if you learn to be who God created you to be first, you work on you, then you won't be worried about trying to fix everybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, parents want children to be who they want them to be instead of letting the children be who God has called them to be.
Mm.
We want to make our kids be what we didn't be in life. We try to make our kids be that.
Yeah, I have been guilty.
You know what I'm saying? You want your kids to be a professional athlete when as close as you got was the bench in high school. Maybe even in Little League. But you think your kid is going to be a superstar. Maybe your child has no desire to play sports anymore. And now you upset with them. Why? That's what you want. That's not who they want to be. Maybe they like to draw. You know what I'm saying? You want your spouse to be the person you don't watch on all these TV shows.
Uh-oh.
The people you see on the magazine. You want that perfect storybook ending to your life.
Mm-hmm.
You got to recognize, hold on. That ain't real life. Because in real life, ups and downs don't get solved within 1 hour.
That 30 minutes.
48 minutes. 22 minutes. It takes time.
Process.
So judge yourself and you'll have no room to judge other people.
And ask God to help you. I will add, ask God to help you be who he called you to be. Because in Jeremiah 29:11, God says he has the plan.
Mm-hmm.
He's already created the blueprint, the plan for our lives. And what we have to do is talk with him to get the plan, read his word. The plan is in this word, in the Bible. But many times we don't want to take the time to read it, or once we do read it, we want it to happen right now. But it has to happen in a sequence of time that God has already set in place.
Amen.
Amen. All right, then. Well, let's move forward. Verse 43, Luke 6:43 says, "For a good tree bringeth forth not corrupt fruit, neither do a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by his own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of a bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh."
Mm-hmm.
Now,
you're gonna break down that fruit, Pastor.
The fruit bad.
What does that mean?
A tree bad tree.
A good tree cannot bring forth bad fruit.
Mm-hmm.
if we was to go over to Galatians 5, we could read about evil and we could read about the fruit of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. We know the fruit of the Spirit produces what? Good fruit. Mm-hmm. You cannot bring good out of evil. Mm-hmm. I don't care how hard you try. You cannot make evil good. If evil is in a person, it's in them. Mm-hmm. If good is in a person, it's in them. However, some of our good, or what we perceive as good, to us ourselves, is based on our upbringing. Mm-hmm.
I was just going to say what is good, because what I think is good, somebody else may think that's not so good. They may think it's bad. It just depends on your perception.
Well, I can tell you right now, I can sum up somebody who's going to bring up good fruit. I can give you that, because I can tell you right now, if a person love God, mm-hmm. and they honor God according to the word, they're going to love their neighbor, mm-hmm. and they're going to treat their neighbor good. Because God is good fruit. I don't care how you look at it. I don't care what happens. Mm-hmm. The love of God is good fruit. That's the first thing it says about the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is love. Mm-hmm. Everything else is in love. So therefore, if love is in me, if agape is in me, that means I have love that's going to treat people right. Love that's not going to wrong people. I got the love of God in me, and His Spirit is going to guide me to always do good.
So it's not just loving the people you like.
No.
Love means everybody, not just your household, not just the people you get along with, but even loving your enemies.
If you go back to Luke 6:27, when we first started, is what was the first thing Jesus said? But I say unto you which hear, love your enemies and do good to them that hate you.
Amen.
So therefore, if love is in me, if the good fruit, if the love of Christ, if I'm being led by the Spirit in love, then what's going to come out of me is love. Even when I'm done wrong, I'm still going to love. Now, I may not associate with you the wrong way, but I'm going to pray for you. I'm not going to speak evil of you, because I know vengeance is of the Lord. But what I am going to do is, if I see you about to fall into a trap, I will warn you.
Amen.
I'm going to forgive you. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that forgiveness is hard. Mm-hmm. It's hard. Like right now, our country is going through a moment to where some people are hating, mm-hmm. and some people are loving. They're practicing the word of God through forgiveness. And what I'm talking about George Floyd. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about Breonna Taylor. I'm talking about Ahmaud Arbery. I'm talking about anywhere injustice is. I don't care whether it's black, white, green, or purple. Anywhere it is, and people are still practicing forgiveness.
Amen.
When the white male killed those black people in that church, people couldn't understand how is it the people in the church can forgive so quickly, because the love of God is in them.
Amen.
They couldn't bring out hate because hate wasn't in them. But for those who don't have the love of God, it was easy to hate.
Amen. And for those of us that don't practice the love of God.
Ooh, say that again.
Because love is
say
a choice. Lie. Just like forgiveness is a choice. You have the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit in us as believers, but we have to practice. We have to let the love of God shed abroad in our heart richly. We have to let the mind of Christ be in us. We have to let us. We have to put aside those things that we know that's not like God and put on the things that we know that are like God, but we have to practice that. If we don't practice that in our...
We're choosing.
You know what I'm saying? If we can't practice that in our home, on our jobs, in our churches, then when the world starts to hit us and punch us in the wrong spot, we're going to react like we always. We're going to practice that old man, that old nature, instead of the new creation that we have in us, which is Christ Jesus.
Amen.
I want to just read a definition, because Pastor Angela just said something. She used the word, but I want to pause. Pastor Sabrina, did you have something you wanted to say in response to her first?
No.
Okay. Pastor Angela said we got to practice love. When I was in growing up, when I played football and softball at Little League stuff, I went to practice almost every day.
Mm-hmm.
When I got in the band, I went to practice every day. Sometimes we went to practice day and night, but I went to practice. But what is practice? How do we define practice? And I just want to take this from the definition. It says, repeated exercise in or performance of an activity or skill so as to acquire or maintain proficiency in it. Mm-hmm. We have to practice love until we do what? Until we acquire a love attitude. Until we can acquire, until we can get good at loving. And then once we get good at loving, we need to practice it even more because we want to maintain that skill.
Amen.
We want to maintain that. That's not something that happens overnight. It's not something that happens when you get dipped in the water, you get belt tied. It ain't something that happens as soon as you go up on the altar and confess with your mouth. No, it starts every time you get offended. It starts in between offense to offense. You have to practice love. And sometimes, some of us, we quit practicing. And the reason we stop practicing, because we get tired and we don't want to do it no more. And once you get tired, and once you don't want to do it no more, you quit. Mm. You quit.
Oh, my God. That reminds me of you said band. I was in the band. I played clarinet. And I think I was third chair, and I wanted to be first chair. So I made that request known to Mr. Pfeiffer, and I wanted to be first chair. He said, well, if you want to be first chair, these are the skills that you got to learn. And when the opportunity comes, I ain't going to tell you when. You're going to have to challenge the first chair person. Ooh. So if you don't, a lot of times we don't want to practice until we know we're going in the game.
Yes, that's true.
We got to always practice like we're going to always be in the game. Thank because the enemy Jesus. Is going to always challenge us and bring us into a situation where we got to be ready to go. You can't be
the
waiting.
The enemy don't tell you I'm coming on May 2nd, 2023.
Amen. You got to practice that thing. And if you never get first chair, you got to practice you in first chair. So Amen. That when you're called on, you can stand up. Otherwise, when you're called on, you're going to be fumbling over those notes. Because he called me. And I was fumbling over those notes. He said, you ain't ready for first
you
chair.
You ain't ready.
So, see, we can want something but until the test comes.
You got to do the work.
You got to do the work. And see, yes, Jesus has already finished it. He finished it, but he put it inside of us so that now we can let it come
out.
We
got to walk it out.
We got to walk it out.
A word that came to mind when Pastor Jane was talking about practice was intentional. Mm. We have to love intentionally. Like, Amen. You're doing it on purpose. In spite of what they do to you, you got to intentionally love. And what is that? Being patient, being kind, being forgiving, being generous, believing the best, hoping the best, praying for them. You have to intentionally do this because sometimes your human fleshy side don't want to do that. You don't want to love. You want to get back.
Amen.
You want them to hurt like they made you hurt. You want to put the look on their face like they put the look on your face. But that is not of God.
That's not of God.
That is not of God. And that is not good fruit.
That's a key sign that you know that that's the old man.
Yes.
Or because a lot of times we want to blame the devil. It's not
the devil. The devil made me do it.
Yeah. It ain't the devil. It's my old nature. My old nature want to see that look on your face. My old nature want to get back with you just like you did to me. But God said,
that ain't what God, that's not love.
And the Holy Spirit empowers us to be able to do it, but we don't call it.
I was going to ask, what do you all think? What do you think about this conversation? Mm. If you have a question, go ahead and post it. Send it out. Are we on the right thing tonight? Are we knocking on your door? Do you need help with something?
I can tell you right now, well, y'all don't knock on my door. Couple times.
All I know is
but this is a thing though. See, we won't change. We got to be willing to change ourselves. Mm-hmm. Change starts with you. You know, and I can tell you right now, we use that example of a band. And I remember when the same band director Pastor Angela had was my band director, her band director, the one we was in high school, and he switched me to tuba. Mm-hmm. Now here it is. I'm playing baritone. He tells me in the middle of the season, hey, you're going to be playing tuba next week. I need you to learn the music.
Next week.
I read treble clef, not bass clef.
You didn't
but
tell
I
me
learned.
No.
But I learned.
You didn't tell. Why didn't you say no?
Yeah, I tried to reason with him, but I was carrying a big old tuba home to practice to get better. And it's the same way with love. You have to practice loving.
Amen.
That's why you heard me say we have to be willing to forgive quickly. Yeah. We don't heal quickly, but we forgive quickly. And the quicker we can forgive, the quicker we can heal. Mm-hmm. And that right there will make it to where we can do what we need to do.
Amen.
What it says, this is the hard choice most times. All right, Steve, I hear you, my brother. Yes. And loving is hard, just like forgiveness is hard sometimes. But one thing I recognize, when you get in God and God gets in you, when you allow the Spirit of God to overtake you, to fill you up, now you are taking on Jesus, and Jesus is doing it, not
yes.
you.
Amen.
Because our flesh wants to do things. Mm-hmm. Our flesh.
There's a battle going on because
The
evil, the devil, don't want to give up. He's going to try to fight you, but you got to stand on that word. You got to keep pressing.
Amen.
Hold on. I see. Can I say a prayer right now for anybody who may be holding unforgiveness? Anybody who may be wanting somebody to feel pain?
Yes.
Anybody still holding on right now and you locked in?
Yes.
And the good fruit of love can't get out of you because that thing is just still hurting on you. Amen. Come on. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you tonight on behalf of those who are watching this broadcast, who are participating. Lord, I ask you to go into their hearts. Father, knock on their door. Father, knock down those walls of unforgiveness. Knock down those walls of hurt and pain and shame. Hallelujah. God, we ask you to fill them up with the love of God. Father, we ask for your forgiveness to cover them all over, God. We pray for the blood of Jesus to be with them and in them and upon them. Lord, we ask them to let go and let you, God. Father, we ask for the manifestation of your healing to take place in their lives now. Father, take the beam out of their eye, God, and let them focus more on themselves so that you can heal them. Father, I ask you to help them to forgive themselves, to forgive those that hurt them, and Father, that you forgive them now. In Jesus' name, amen, 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 amen.
Hallelujah.
Listen, you got to let go. You can't keep holding on.
Hallelujah.
Let me tell you what unforgiveness leads to. Unforgiveness causes us to have no peace, but it causes stress.
Amen.
Stress causes our body to bear burdens such as weight gain, heart disease, sicknesses, illnesses, high blood pressure. You can lose your mind. You can lose your eyesight. You can lose yourself because of unforgiveness. You have to let it go. God forgave you and me and Pastor Sabrina and Pastor Angela. He forgave us for our mess. And right now, he wants you to forgive those who have messed you up, who have messed over you. Otherwise, you can't produce good fruit. See, because when you're mad at somebody else, you'll take it out on those who love you the most.
Yeah.
First of all, you're going to take it out on your family.
Your family.
Whether you're married or not. If you're not married, you're going to take it out on your kids.
The dog.
Your pets. You will take it out on those who love you the most, and you're going to go around fronting, faking. Putting a smile on your face when you're mad as hell on the inside. You got to let it go.
I will offer this. I'm going to just share something personal. When I got married at 25 years old, and I didn't know, I love my dad. I didn't grow up in the house with him. And I guess I was angry and had been suppressing it. But for some reason, soon after I got married, all these feelings that I had when I was a little girl started coming up. And I didn't know what to do with him. I mean, I love my dad. I didn't want to call him. I didn't want to disappoint him by saying those things to him. But keeping them on the inside of me was choking me.
Mm-hmm.
So what I did, I got a legal pad and I started writing. I'm telling you, I wrote front and back about 10 pages. I started back as far as I can remember when I was a little girl about the vacations that I wanted to go on and I couldn't go, that I wasn't like the other children, that I wasn't in the house with you, why you and my mama gave me to my grandma. I mean, I went, but once I finished writing everything and sealed up that envelope, I felt a release. Like I didn't feel whatever that was anymore. I didn't even know I was angry. Just one day it started bubbling over. And the only thing I knew to do was to write about it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I did, because my father was still alive, I mailed it to him. Mm-hmm. And when he got it, I knew it because he called me. He said, we need to talk. Mm-hmm. And he came to my house, picked me up, and we went out to talk for hours and hours and hours. Mm-hmm. Now, if the person you are angry at, if you're not in a position, you may not be in a position that that is a person you may want to talk to, because depending on the way in which you got hurt. But if you can't go to them or if they are dead, you can write about it. You can get, you need to get those feelings out in some way. So maybe you can write it all out to get it out, seal it up in an envelope, mm-hmm. and then set it on fire. You don't have to send it off. I just happened to send mine off, and it made the relationship better that I had with my father. I love my father unconditionally. I accept him for who he is. I hold nothing against my father. Some of my siblings would say, you think dad perfect. I do. Even though, and they'll say, well, what about this and what about that? And I say, what about it? It is a choice. I chose to let it go. Mm-hmm. I chose to love unconditionally. And intentionally, I love my dad. Intentionally. And you have to do that. You can't allow the person who made you feel hurt win. They don't even know you still hurting. They are winning every day because you choose to hold on to those thoughts. The word says, cast down every imagination and every lofty thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And how do you cast those things down? You put the word of God on it. Amen. You come back with a scripture to put the word of God on it. I love my neighbors as I love myself. Amen. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I'm a daughter of the King. I am free. I am delivered. I am redeemed from the curse of the law. I love because God is giving me love. God is love. You have to, when those thoughts come, that's how you cast it down. You may have to write some scriptures down and keep them in your pocket, in your wallet, your purse, by your bed. And when them thoughts come, you got to jump up, grab it, and say it until you memorize them so you can come out. Because the devil is not going to stop coming at you to remind you of what happened yesterday or last year or 10 years ago or who wasn't there or who walked out. It's done. They're gone. It happened. Even if they wanted to take it back, they can't because it's a fact. It happened. But the word is what is true. The word is what you have to choose to lean on, trust in, and believe in now. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And that's true. And Pastor Sabrina, that was, that hit straight on. That hit straight on. A lot of time, you know, we go through some things and then sometimes you may have been the offender.
Yeah.
You may have been the one who have offended somebody. You know, you may have been the one that was wrong and did wrong and misused and abused somebody. You just have to forgive yourself. And you have to know that God loves you and he can help you and he can change you from the inside out. A lot of times we look at the person that was hurt, but then the person that also did it hurt, Jesus died for that person as well. So a lot of times we got to understand that God loves all of us.
All of us.
And he has a plan for all of us. He forgives all of us. But a lot of times when I'm hurt or somebody that I know hurt, it hurts me. And it makes me want to see something happen, but I know that's not God. So when I feel like that, that's the flesh. You know, I'm walking in the flesh. I'm not walking in the spirit. I'm not following the spirit of God. So I have to quickly check myself and say, okay, now look, I'm weak right here. So I need to call somebody that's strong and say, I need you to pray for me because right now I'm hurting. And this is what I want to do.
We're better together.
You know, because if you don't, you're going to do or say something. But see, that's when you know you want to do what's right. I done been in some situations where I had to call on you guys. And I had to call on some people that I know love me that's going to not talk about me. Pray for me.
Yeah, because you're ready to burn it down.
Because I'm just real. Because then I had to look at it. And when I went to God, after I got prayer, God began to show me some things of how I hurt other people. And he said, now I forgave you. As a matter of fact, I didn't just forgive you, but I covered it up. Nobody knows about it.
Jesus, love covers.
I loved you. I covered you, and I hid that thing, and I threw it so far. You trying to fish and remember it. So when I started thinking about it like that, that changed my heart towards the person that I wanted God to deal with. And it allowed me to now show the love of God and say, okay, well, God, you love me like that? Okay, God, I'm sorry. Forgive me for wanting you to judge that person and wanting this person to go through hell like they took me through hell. Forgive me for doing that. Because you love them just like you love me. You have no respect for a person. You love all of us. But when we see it that way, then we can kind of change our perspective on how we look at it.
Jesus.
Amen. Ooh, boy, that's two mouthfuls. But let me just say something. When we get hurt, and as Christians, you know, you save, you gave your life to God, you doing your best to walk like God. Let me tell you something. We go through some human emotions. We go through some human thinking. Ooh. We go through some human feelings. And sometimes we act just like humans. Mm-hmm. You know, we curse, we yell, we scream, we throw things, and we ask God for forgiveness for all of it. And that's not no excuse to keep doing that. But what I'm trying to do is get us to be real and be transparent to understand on this walk with Christ, there's going to come times in our lives when sometimes some rotten fruit going to come out of us. Not saying that everything in us is rotten, but sometimes God is going to allow things to offend us that, hey, it's just going to show us some areas.
Says, be angry, but sin not.
Right, that we just going to have to work on. So we have to just keep on going and keep going. But I don't want you to allow what people do to you or what the world do to you or what the devil used people to do to you to make you just feel like you're not worthy, to make you feel like, oh, I just got to act like this. No, you don't.
You can't trust someone else.
Yes, because as long as you're getting the word in you and you're allowing that word to take over, baby, you are a tree that produces good fruit.
Amen.
You are a tree of love. You know, you don't have to act like what you used to act like. Let them see something different because, see, when the Holy Spirit gets in you and gets on you, you begin to lose weight. And what I mean by that, things that used to affect you after spending time with God don't affect you so easily no more. You know what I'm saying?
Jesus.
It's like you get in this word and you allow the word to get in you. You may have to turn off that secular music for a while so that you can only put gospel in you. You may have to turn off the Real Housewives or whatever city they live in. You know what I'm saying? You may have to turn off that sports channel and just watch some good gospel stuff. Watch some preaching and some teaching that's going to help you. You know what I'm saying? So basically what I'm saying is you have to take a spiritual laxative. You got to get you some Exalax, which is this word.
Yeah.
And let this word get in you and clean all that evil stuff out of you because you was raised on cussing and fussing. Now you gave your life to God. Now all of a sudden, you got to be, all that mess got to be cleaned out.
Jesus.
Your whole system got to be renewed.
You backed up, stopped up.
You backed up, stopped up. You constipated, got to go to the doctor because ain't nothing working. And hey, they got to give you a real enema, a real injection from the rear end to just clean you out. God is doing the same thing with this word. The word is coming to do what? To clean you out. To cleanse your spirit. To cleanse your mind. To cleanse your emotions. To cleanse, you know, your will, your intellect. Even physically, because when you begin to lose some of this mental and emotional weight, when you begin to drop that off, your body responds in turn.
Jesus. As Pastor Tabitha Wilkerson said at our women conference last October, take the mask off.
Ooh,
become
hallelujah.
The authentic you. Amen. We hide behind so many things. We hide behind our makeup. We hide behind our jobs. We hide behind our titles, our positions, our family, what we think, what we want people to see. We put up a front. But it's time to snatch that veil off and get ourselves together.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So true. So true. Brother Steve, hey, I appreciate you, man. Talking about this is food for the nourishment of our souls. And hey, it's nourishing me too. All right, let's move on to verse number 40. Let's just look at 45 from a different translation. I just want to read just a part of that. And it's the end part from the Passion Translation. It says, for the overflow of what has been stored in your heart will be seen by your fruit and will be heard in your words. If you listen to people long enough, you will hear
what's in
them.
Abundance of the
heart. Not only will you see it, but you hear it. See, you can only fake the funk for so long. Know what I'm saying? You can only fake for so long. And if you keep listening to a person, listening to how they talk, you will get to know the real person. Not the person you want to know, but you'll see, like that song from Kodak, I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. Mm-hmm. Some people are like chameleons. They change with the environment. But if you stay with them long enough, you'll get to know when they get ready to switch out on you because you'll see the change coming.
I was going to say, I have, in counseling people to get married, when we're one-on-one, one thing I tell them, I said, you've seen the good side, because, you know, when we're dating, we show our good side. I said, make them mad as hell. What can make them mad? Figure out what that is and keep pushing that button. You're going to see who they really are. Okay. If they stay understanding and compassionate and they just try to calm you down, then you know who they really are. But if they start cussing or raise their hand up at you and start breaking stuff, run. Time to go. Let it go. I don't care if you bought the dress. Run. I don't care if they bought the house. Run. Amen. Leave. Get out.
And that's true because, you know, a lot of times we haven't really been taught how to allow the word of God that we read, the written word, to become rhema word. That rhema word become living word, where we now not only read it so that we can memorize it, but we read it so we can do it. You know, and when we trying to do the word, we can't do the word outside of the Holy Spirit helping us do the word.
That's it.
And see, a lot of times we try to do it. Yeah, I can do it for a little while when I'm doing it in my own strength. But when I'm doing it, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When I'm doing it through the strength of Christ, then I can continue to do it. So what really gets me is that a lot of times we, as what we call seasoned saints, we... And a lot of the Pharisees and Sadducees are what was called seasoned saints. You know, they can do the word. They knew the word. They can memorize the word. I mean, they can memorize the word. They can quote the word. But Jesus said, I know what's in your heart.
Amen.
See, a lot of times, as you said, fake the funk. You can fake the funk and walk around like you're doing the word. But when Jesus said, no, I can show you, like the woman caught in adultery, you want to stone her. Now I'm going to show you so you can put your rock down. So none of us can throw rocks at anybody. You know, even like she just used the analogy about when you push that button and you find that button is there, then you run. When you find that button, I didn't know I had some buttons.
Not sweet you?
Yeah.
What?
I didn't know I had some buttons. But when the button got pushed, I knew that it was there. I would have never thought. And this is how God began to deal with me, because he said, you know, a person with my personality, my disposition can be perceived as a good person, but there is nobody good outside of Christ. None of us are good outside of Christ. None of us are good outside of Christ. In all of our goodness, we still as a filthy rag outside of Christ. So when we look at it like that, then we can say, okay, I seen that ugly side of you, I have to pray for you now. And see, now when I pray for you, I'm going to now be in the presence of God while I'm praying for you, so now I can see you differently. Mm-hmm. But if I'm praying for you just out of what the words say, then I'm not going to see you differently. I'm just going to say a prayer.
Amen.
I can't see you the way God sees you. You know what I'm saying? I can't see your hurt. God can't show me how you was abused and misused and how you was molested and how you was, whatever, all the stuff that happened to you to make me see you differently. You know what I'm saying? I can't see you that way. So when he starts showing me the real you and what causes you to act the way you're acting.
There's a reason.
Exactly. That changes how I see you now. So now I can really pray for you, not from a point of me trying to say, oh man, I'm going to pray for you, right? Let me go, Father, in the name of Jesus. Da, 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 boom, boom. Let me go. No, I'm going to intercede for you. That means I'm going to fervently pray for you until I see a change. I'm going to stay in there. I'm not going to run away. I'm going to stay until I see a change. That's
love being patient.
And that's love being acted out.
Mm-hmm. It's the action word.
Amen.
You got something else you want to share with the people?
I forgot. I was going to say something. Something that she said made me go get this book.
Mm.
So it says, successful women think differently.
Mm.
Now, usually...
Don't tell that story.
Yep, because she don't tell it, I'm going to tell it.
When I just know when I'm going to be attacked by the enemy. I just hear this quiet little, you're going to be attacked. Like, and I heard it. And I'm like, I'm going to be attacked. Ain't everything going good in the woods? Oh, so We ten weapons. Like, what in the world? Like, okay, God, you don't miss it. But I was like, okay, I'm gonna be looking for the attack. Didn't thought it was this book. Now, when you see this book, you'll probably say, well, what does she mean she got attacked? Well, my husband went on a trip to the store.
The book is called Successful Women Think Differently. 9 Habits to Make You Happier, Healthier, and More Resilient. Ooh. I didn't read that part. I just read the top part. But go ahead, tell the story.
Well, my husband came home from Publix. I asked him to bring me something back. You know, I was talking about a snack, some chips. You know, some of that junk food that the doctor said I'm not supposed to have. Mm. So he didn't see, I didn't give him specifically what I wanted. So he brings his book back.
He asked you what you wanted.
He asked me what I wanted. I didn't know. He said, text me. I didn't text him. I just figured he'll bring me some chips or M&M's. But he brought this book back. Why did the man do that? I attacked this man in front of people. I don't even know if I apologize. Pastor Angela was still here. I thank God that he allowed her to stay and still be here, because it would have got ugly.
No, it wouldn't.
I would have got ugly.
Because I asked her to give me back the book.
What's the reasoning in the room?
And I was just going to take it out. Because this went on for about an hour. An hour.
So you don't think I'm successful? What's wrong with my thinking? So I'm slow. So I'm something wrong with me. What you trying to say? So I start flipping through the book. Why you think I needed this book? Mm. Out of all the things in Publix, you go pick me up a book? You couldn't get M&M's?
Just like that, y'all.
I went through the roof.
Pastor Angela, you can correct me from I didn't raise my voice.
He didn't.
Only thing I said was, I thought it was a nice book. That's all I can say. Besides, give me the book back, I'll take it back.
Who know they have a book section in Publix? Nobody go looking for a book.
It's written about customer service out here in Loxahatchee.
I mean, I went from zero to like a million burning down buildings quick.
By the book.
By book. And then I said, and I think I got that book anyway. Mm-hmm. If I wanted to read it, I would have read it when I bought it. Mm-hmm. I would, no matter what he said, he was going to be wrong. He was so calm. Mm-hmm. He stayed calm. Nothing he said was going to be right. Mm-hmm. I just kept attacking. I don't even know, did I ever apologize?
I don't know, but I'm mad now because I see that your book was $3.99.
And that's what made me mad.
$2.99, I paid more than that for mine.
He got his from Publix. I got mine from Diddy's.
I didn't know.
But it really is a good book. I started reading the book.
Hey, that was confirmation. Out of the mouth of two
I already
three
had
pieces.
The book.
That was a second book.
So
but
it really is
but
a good read.
It just goes to show you how we as Christian, even husband and wife, we can get upset sometime and go off.
I did. And I love my husband.
Just a little thing. Because I was like, I would think to myself.
I love you, babe.
Yeah, I love you too. I asked her what she wanted because, you know, she know me. And I'm going to be real.
I want a snack.
I'm real simple. I'm straight to the point. If you tell me you want A, you getting A. I ain't going to be no variation. I ain't thinking about B. I'm getting A. I go to the store to get what I want and I'm going home. I don't want to shop. I don't want to walk around. I want to get what I came to get, and I want to go home. So she didn't tell me what she wanted. I thought it was something good. My spirit was at peace, and I'm still at peace about it.
I let the devil use. I don't know if it was the devil using me. I did that.
Either way it goes, it was her flesh, and I was still chilling.
It was terrible.
So y'all can see from this story, I let the good fruit of my heart come out of me.
He did, because I wouldn't let up. He kept trying to end it. I knew he was trying to end it. I kept pushing. Pastor Angela tried to intervene. She know what to do. She was trying to keep it all calm. She was all nice and sweet. I was still coming back. But man, he's a real man of the word, I'm telling you. Because if he wasn't, he would have smashed my head to one of these.
But to your defense, you wasn't
She evil. Just wanted to know why.
She wasn't evil. She was asking a lot of questions behind his motives for giving you the book and not bringing some chips.
Yeah, I'm like, it got to be something. Made you pick up that book out of all the books.
She read deeper into the book than what I thought.
She's very analytical.
Very, very analytical. If you want something analyzed, here's your consultant. You just want it simple, straight, call me. And if you want in between, and going to get you... Call Pastor Angela. I'm just going to tell you the truth. But let's move on. We got a few more scriptures before we close out.
Okay.
And it says this here in verse 46, it says, "And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" Mm-hmm. Now this right here, this is a heavyweight hitter here.
Call me Lord.
Many of us call Jesus Lord, but we don't do what he tells us to do. We don't follow the voice of God when it's speaking to us. So he said, "Why are you going to call me Lord of your life?
Do what I say.
And you don't do what I say." It sounded like to me Jesus was calling them, "You're a liar." How can you say, "I am your Lord, I am your master, but you don't do the things that I tell you to do?" I tell y'all, boy, the Holy Spirit done jacked me up a couple times. Or 200. Because when the Lord begins to chastise you for not doing what he's telling you to do, it's going to hurt harder than when mama and daddy spanked your behind. Because God going to spank your spirit. And that spirit is going to cause you to not get no rest. So if you're going to call Jesus Lord, it ain't no voice that's yelling at you. It's going to be a soft, it's going to be a calm voice. Well, it's going to be a voice you already know. It may sound just like you. But it's the voice of God telling you what to do. And you know what to do.
As it comes from the word.
And let me say this. That go for your Facebook post too. Don't post good and evil.
Amen.
Pick a side. You can't straddle the fence.
Who's your baddie?
If you want to post evil, stay with evil. Because people are looking at you and judging you and saying, "Wait a minute. You want to tell me at 6 a.m. to praise the Lord. But at 8 a.m. you want to repost whoever done posted that's full of cussing and hell. You want to repost that at 8. But you want to dare, or you want to come back at 12 and say, "Let's pray together." Who we praying to?
Jesus.
Well, Pastor, can I say something?
Go ahead on. She got a one thing. Y'all, she's going to go to the bathroom. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I'm going to say this.
Go ahead.
A lot of us ain't going to post it, but we still going to do it, and we still going to say it. So I still would rather see somebody post it so I know how to pray.
I don't
want to
see me.
Wait.
All right.
Because you still got people in the process. You still got people that's learning and they're going through a transformation process. Okay? So we still trying to, you know, you got different people that's on different levels and they walk with Christ. So when I see the post, I know how to pray. You don't peep your hand, I know how to pray. And I might call you and say, "Well, you know, or you might call me. I hope I ain't putting nothing out there." All right. So you might call me and say, "That post that you posted, is everything okay?" And I might say, "Well, you know what? I took it down. But at that time, I was going through something. And I knew they was on my page. And I don't think I ever did this, but I'm just saying. We are real people. Okay. We got people that's in different levels and going through things at different times and on different maturity levels in this walk with Christ. So you're gonna have different mindsets at certain times. You're not gonna have the mind of Christ all the time because you're still in this flesh. And this flesh, the Bible say, "Let this mind that be in you be in Christ Jesus." So at the time when I'm doing that other thing, I'm not letting the mind of Christ. I'm even letting the mind of Ann, or I'm letting the mind of Satan rule and dominate me at that point.
That is true. I understand what both of your points. Pastor James is saying, don't be wishy-washy. Don't be lukewarm. Mm-hmm. Either you're for God or you're not. And Pastor Angela is saying some people are in a process, so they're learning the things of God. They're growing in God, but that old man still keeps trying to come in. But it could confuse some people who are babes in Christ, and they think you way along in Christ because you've been going to that church for 10 years or 5 years or 3 years, and they just start going to church. So they can get confused by your post if they're friends with you. So it's up and down.
Okay, that's true.
That's when some mature Christian who sees it need to inbox them and say, hey, I need to call you or call them up.
That's right.
Because if you don't know them, if you're friends with them, you can call them if you go to Messenger.
Right.
Doesn't give you their phone number, but you can hit that call button and give them a call. And as a brother or sister in Christ, we are responsible to be our brother and sister's keepers.
Yes.
Sometimes we see things going on in someone's life and we say we're going to pray about it quietly at home and we never say anything to them.
Yes.
Maybe God allowed you to see it so you can say something.
Yes.
That's kind of like your bestie, best friend, your good friend walking around with a booger in their nose at work or at church, greeting everybody and smiling. And instead of you giving them a tissue and say, girl, clean your nose up, man. You got some in your nose, go check your nose. You just do your pleasantries, speak and walk away. And then now the next person seeing it. 10 people done saw you with your nose like that.
Come on.
And nobody said anything.
Yes,
or
yes.
Your shirt on backwards.
Yes.
Or you got on the wrong color shoes. Or you been cussing. Or you been doing something showing your behind.
Mm.
And we're not stepping up as a sister and brother in Christ and say, hey, that don't look good.
Amen.
I know you were upset.
Mm-hmm.
I know you didn't like what they said, but there could have been a better way that could have been handled.
Yes.
Can I pray with you?
That's it.
That's
our
it.
Responsibilities as sisters and brothers in Christ.
That's it. That's
amen. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, Steve. Bro, Steve, we appreciate you. You know, we're going to come back to the last four scriptures next.
What is 8 o'clock?
Next Wednesday. Because, you know, we do have a timekeeper.
Oh, man, I messed up tonight. I done went past the
so,
clock.
I really hope that everybody's getting something out of this.
Amen.
My brother Steve Kovaski, hey, you still got my number? Give me a call tomorrow. If not, DM me or I'll DM you my number so you can call me. It's so good to hear from you. So good to see you, my brother. I miss you. But I thank y'all for joining us tonight. I know last night during my prayer, I said I was going to be praying on Tuesday and Thursday, but my spirit was not at rest with that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, because of my work schedule, we're going to pray at 6:30, starting on Monday morning. But we are going to pray Friday at 7:15. But we're going to have prayer on Monday mornings
Friday
at 6:30. Friday morning at 7:15, or this Friday at 7:15. But we're going to do Monday mornings at 6:30. So I'm going to be up praying, and at 6:30, we're going in the battle.
We're
going in the battle.
I'm going to try to join y'all.
So we're going to be praying on there, but join us Sunday morning at 9 a.m. We'll be back having a good time in the Lord. And hey, and I appreciate y'all. I love y'all. Still praying for you. And go back and watch this. Share this with your friends. Hey, follow us on YouTube.
Send us
you
questions
know,
if you
Pastor
have.
Pastor James and Sabrina Wilkerson. Like, subscribe, and share our page, our YouTube page. This will be on YouTube tonight. So that you can let other people know, hey, they can go watch it on YouTube.
Amen.
And just know, hey, that we love you. Also, too, we're looking forward to trying to find us a place to have our church, to build a church or whatever, so you can support us. Y'all see below us, where in green, that you can text GivePC3 to the number 54244. You'll get a link on how you can support this ministry financially. To my Peniel Covenant Christian Center family, know, hey, that I love you and I miss you.
Love y'all.
And so I want us to have a good night. Keep praying for our country and this world, because truly there is no black and white, because as a Christian, when you see through the blood of Jesus, you see your brothers and sisters in love. So we know haters are the devil, and we are of God because we love. So I'm going to ask my wife, Pastor Sabrina, if she have anything, or Pastor Angela has anything, and after that, ask my wife to close us out in prayer. So if you ladies have anything y'all want to say in closing?
I'm tapped out.
All right, well, Pastor Sabrina, you'll close us out in prayer.
Yes, I will. I want everyone to lift your hands as a sign of surrender to the Most High God. Father, in the name of Jesus, we give you thanks. We give you honor. We give you praise, oh God. We thank you for the word that went forth tonight, God. We thank you that you anointed our ears to hear, our eyes to see, and our heart to receive what you have for us, God. Lord, we receive your goodness. We receive your correction. We receive your discipline. We receive your love. And God, most of all, we receive forgiveness from you, O God.
Thank you, Lord.
Let us forgive as you forgive us, O God. Let us check and judge our own self, God, before we go try to check someone else, God. Give us a heart and a mind to love like you love, God.
Yes,
open our eyes to see people like you see them, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Let us choose to forgive them, God, to pray for them, to do well to our enemies, oh God, so that we may become brothers
thank
and
you,
sisters
Lord.
In Christ, if it be your will, God. Lord, we're just so thankful and so grateful to you, oh God. Until we meet again, oh God, peace be unto everyone. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Well, hey, on behalf of myself, Pastor James, my wife, Pastor Sabrina, Pastor Angela, our families, and the church family of Peniel Covenant Christian Center, we thank you for joining us tonight. So until we meet again, have a blessed evening. We love you. God bless you. Peace.
Love you.